And, you know, it's it. Our first impressions form our influence, how we perceive everything else that we see from the city. And so we found downtown to be extremely, and the right, and taking the right places downtown to be extremely effective, both overall and with specific candidates who had not, who may or may not have been in Cleveland. The first time I stepped foot in Cleveland was when I interviewed at Jones Day. If you would have told my 22-year-old self that my 31-year-old self would be living in Cleveland, Ohio, I would have at least laughed at you, if not probably thought you were an idiot. So without boring you with my own personal story, it's, I view myself at least as one of the type of people, if you can indulge me in the possible fiction that I am talent, that I'm one of the people we want to try to bring into the city. So.
Let me ask you though, what was your first impression, 22-year-old David, when you set foot in Cleveland, and how is that any different now, 9 years later?
Well, I was actually 25 when I first set foot in Cleveland, and I thought it was a cold, windy, nasty mess. I was staying over at, and very empty. I was staying over at the Wyndham, and it was a night where there wasn't a show. And, you know, I don't know if you've ever been in that area on a night when there aren't any shows playing. It was a Sunday night. There's no one there. And especially then, really the only even bars or anything that were open there on non-theater nights was the hotel bar. And, of course, I didn't know anything about the area. So I didn't know that, you know, about West 6th or even about the Weeping Lizard down the street. You know, the East 4th District wasn't there then. So I thought, wow, you know, even if I really like this firm, why would I want to live in this city? You know, I was picked up for dinner in a car and driven over to the Chop House, but I'm not familiar with the area. We're driving around. We're driving sort of down East 18th Street, and I'm looking around like, well, there's a college there and this divey bar. And I mean, it did. Luckily, some of these things appealed to my 25-year-old self, but not in a good way. And, you know, just seeing how the neighborhoods have changed. I've lived just around the corner on Euclid and East 3rd for about 4 years now, and before that I lived over on West 9th. So, you know, I see myself, and I've seen downtown evolve and grow up, and it's something that, you know, has made me passionate about downtown. So,
Chris Sepper from Med City News, who, when you first came to Cleveland to work for the Plain Dealer, lived downtown. What was your impression as a person? I remember you wrote a column back then about what you needed to do, what the city of Cleveland needed to do in order to make this a hospitable place for young talent to come in. Again, nominally using the word talent.
Yeah, thank you.
In your case as well.
I'll take what I can get.
But since the time you wrote that column, has there been change? Is Cleveland a place where young people would want to come and work if they were being sought after by more than one place?
I think so. I lived in Lakewood for about for a few years, and then moved down once I got married. So not only I lived downtown as newlyweds, and we actually stayed downtown because we liked it so much. We lived right at the corner of West 9th and Superior until our son was almost 2 years old, and we had another on the way. We just ran out of space, and they went backyards. The problems back then were similar to some of the problems now. It was infrastructure. I had to drive, you know, to another part of town to get a DVD. I remember when we were looking for apartments downtown, there was one apartment manager who opens her office and says, look, I've got these video cassettes for you. If you ever need to come down, that was her way to kind of stem the tide. Netflix is thankfully taking care of that. The post office downtown closes on the weekends. There's no quick access to that. Lots of infrastructure things. There was a perception of a crime problem. That wasn't a crime problem. It was a homeless problem. You know, I'd take my son out for a stroll, and you know, I'd see a few folks yelling at the pigeons, calling them ugly chickens, right? That was problematic for people who wanted to live downtown, young professionals or beyond. What's interesting is how that has been taken care of in the time since I've left. Netflix takes care of one thing, right? But Downtown Cleveland Alliance had a program to kind of address the issue of panhandling and homelessness, and that's helped. I think that when I moved into the Perry Payne building, I looked out and saw cranes that were building things. I said, this is a great sign, and that's come true. You know, the East 4th District is a perfect example of that. We passed on that area at that time when we were moving there. It was when did I get married? Late 2001, because that was because that was being built, and my wife said, "There's no way on earth that we're living in this area that's dank and dark and screams danger." Now it's robust and beautiful, and there are beautiful areas there. So there definitely has been an improvement you see. I think Cleveland downtown, one of the keys to success just generally, is Cleveland needs to be Cleveland. If people have lived in D.C., they know of Adams Morgan, and that area is a robust area with a robust nightlife and awful parking, terrible parking. And I don't think that most people in Adams Morgan say, golly, we got to fix the parking here, because this is what they are, and it's robust and it's exciting. Cleveland is a city of neighborhoods, or even districts. I mean, you can walk from the Warehouse District to East 4th, but you usually don't, right? But those are two vibrant areas. And when I went shopping downtown, when I lived downtown, I thought it was kind of idyllic. There was no downtown grocery store, which people complained about, but I'd stroll to the West Side Market, haggle, get the good produce, right? Fight for the good produce and the meat, go across the street to the other supermarket. That's a downtown life. I think sometimes we try to make downtown for the suburbanites, when downtown is for downtown folks. And if you play to the strengths, the great restaurants, you know, fantastic wine bars, you know, the urban core as it is truly defined in a traditional way, I think downtown's going to be okay to recruit a broad collection of people.
Dan Barry, is it a residential issue, or is it instead an issue about making downtown a great place for everyone to sort of feel good about, even the ones that don't live there? Are you concerned about people living here?
Well, I think so, and as I mentioned earlier, I think it's a tripartite issue. It's downtown is a place to work, and what are the amenities that can support that and make companies want to be here and help them attract talent. It's a place to live, and encouragingly in Cleveland, as I mentioned, the population is growing as we've added more housing opportunities. Right now, we have at least three major new housing developments that are online, 668 Euclid, the Atrium building next door here, and the 12th Street Avenue District, all of which are new developments that have as their target attracting young professionals to live in downtown. So that's very encouraging. And then finally, as was alluded to earlier, it's a place to have fun and network and meet other people. And East 4th Street, Flats East Bank Project, the neighborhoods around town are all critical. So I wouldn't I think it's a combination of all three of those issues.
And you talked about the desire to attract young professionals. The concern I have when I hear that is really Cleveland as a place that's growing business. What about that aspect of it? In order to attract young people, you really need great places to work in the first place.
Yeah, that's a fundamental issue, and really has been a primary concern at the Greater Cleveland Partnership, that the fundamental challenge in this region and community is to increase job growth so that we have more opportunities that we can use to attract young people. And that consumes much of what the Greater Cleveland Partnership is about, trying to put in place systems that can help create more jobs. At the same time, we time and time hear from our companies that some of them are having difficulty filling positions. So there is an issue around, we do have some jobs. The perception is that there aren't as many as there are, so we do need to do a much more effective job in marketing what we have. And that is part of what we've been trying to do with our new regional marketing effort called Cleveland Plus, is to try to make folks aware that this is a vibrant, more vibrant economy than they believe, and that there is opportunity that they don't know about.
David DeBoard from Jones Day, when we talked on the phone a little bit before this event to sort of feel out what our thoughts are on this, you made a very convincing argument and statement. Cleveland is not New York City. Nor is it Los Angeles. And we talked about that, the idea that we talk about how great Cleveland is and we're attracting young talent, but we're not competing with New York City or Los Angeles, are we? What is the competition for Cleveland?